Doing well, doing well.
So if you would introduce yourself and what are you here to do today, Jeff?
My name is Jeff Butler. I'm a serial entrepreneur and I'm here today to talk to you about smartphone addiction.
Okay, and this is, what place is this again? We are?
This is the Sunday Assembly in
East Bay. Don't forget the East Bay.
East Bay.
And fantastic. We're about to start our program. Thank you so very much. Hey Siri, how you doing?
Good. Lauren, this is Wilma.
Wilma, how you doing?
All right. She doesn't want her image used.
Pardon?
Wilma doesn't want her image used.
Okay. She's going to be an anonymous face in the crowd.
That'd be okay.
Okay, but I will endeavor to not take pictures of you. How's that?
Okay.
Okay?
Perfect. Thank you so much.
Okay.
Thank you.
So since there are elements of our assembly today that are dealing with technology, we have been a failure with technology all morning since 9:30. So we are working on being able to start in like so soon. And just flying in with a USB jump drive. It's going to happen. But we're happy to see you here today on this wonderful Father's Day. We're going to get started as we do. You can plug it into the right side of my computer and we can just play it. We'll just do it. Do I need help? My name's Hester. I'm going to be your really frazzled host this morning. And we're going to figure things out. So we're going to start with some songs. They're going to be ready. Then we're going to have some awesome speakers. We're going to celebrate life and energy and being present, right? Today's theme is being present. So let's all just be present. Actually, can I just start with the icebreaker that I was going to do while we were doing that? Okay, so hi everyone, and welcome to Sunday Assembly East Bay. Happy So if you're live streaming this right now. So normally we start with songs. We're gonna flip it today. We're gonna start with the icebreaker. Find somebody that you don't know, and in honor of Father's Day, I did this on Mother's Day too. So in honor of Father's Day, I would like you to discuss with a person that you don't know your favorite either TV, film, or literary dad figure. So everything from, I don't know, Mr. Brady to, I don't know, any others that I can think of. So everybody, use your brains, think of famous dads, and talk to somebody you don't know for a couple minutes about them. And we'll be back to hear some of your stories in a moment. Ready? Go!
But now officially welcome to each of you. We gather here to celebrate life Whether we are atheists, agnostic, free thinkers, humanists, spiritual, we are diverse people who come together to create a community of connection to live better, help often, and wonder more. How many people are here for the first time today? Leave your hands up, turn to somebody, give them a high five. A couple songs, and hopefully it will all work to our advantage. We invite you all to stand up if you are comfortable and sing along.
Just pretend it's Friday night and you're in a diaper. That's so small.
about being present, accepting all of the things that are in the moment in our lives, both good, bad, and the ugly, I believe. So we're going to start with a reading. Please welcome Mike Hines to do the reading.
Try to combine the two things we have today, being present with Father's Day, and I found out there on the interwebs a site called A Year of Being Here, Daily Mindfulness Poetry by Wordsmiths of the Here and Now. And surprisingly or not, they had two poems about Father, so here we go. First one's by Amy Fleury, called Abolition. Because one of us must be naked to get clean, my dad shrugs out of his pajama shirt, steps from his boxers and into the tub as I brace him, whose long illness has made him shed modesty too. Seated on the plastic bench, he holds the soap like a caught fish in his lap, waiting for me to test the water's heat on my wrist before turning the nozzle toward his pale skin. He leans over to be doused, then hands me the soap so I might scrub his shoulders and neck. Suds sluicing from spine to buttock cleft. Like a child, he wants a washcloth to cover his eyes while lathering a palmful of pearlescent shampoo into his craniotomy scarred scalp, and then rinse clear whatever soft hair is left. Our voice echoing the spray and steam of this room where once, long ago, he knelt at the tub's edge to pour cups of backwater over my head. He reminds me to wash behind his ears, and when he judges himself to be clean, I turn off the tap. He grips the safety bar, steadies himself and stands. Turning to me, his body is dripping in frail and pink. And although I'm nearly 40, he has this one last thing to teach me. I hold open the towel to receive him. The second poem, from Sheila Packett, called Not Forgotten. I learned to ride the two-wheel bicycle with my father. He oiled the chain, clothespin playing cards to the spokes, put on the basket to carry my lunch. By his side, I learned balance and took on speed centered behind the wide handlebars, my hands on the white grips, my feet pedaling. One moment, he was holding me up, and the next moment, although I didn't know it, he had let go. When I wobbled, suddenly afraid, he yelled, "Keep going, keep going." Beneath the trees in the driveway, the distance increasing between us, I eventually rode until he was out of sight. I counted on him. That he could hold me was a gift. That he could release me was a gift.
Happy Father's Day.
Our speaker today is Jeff Butler, president and H&B provider, is that correct? Serial software entrepreneur and psychology fanatic. He is a graduate from UC Berkeley with a degree in computer science. He recently left an occupation as a software engineer, and this is really hard to read off of my smartphone, to help smartphone users overcome addictions and better use smartphone technology. When I'm better prepared, I tend to not like to do this on my phone, but today was one of those days. He stated that many young people are addicted to their phones and don't even realize it. So let's all welcome Jeff.
Well, hello there. Happy Father's Day. What's really exciting about the speech is that I started to do a TEDx in a month. And part of the speech is going to be on TEDx, so you get a sneak peek TEDx. So, happy Father's Day, everyone. Hope everyone's having a great time. I never actually had two songs to warm up before I speak, so hopefully I'm a little more easier to hear because I'm a little more warmed up in my vocal cords. So in my speech, I'd like to get an idea of the crowd I'm talking to. To get an idea, how many of you have a smartphone? Just raise your hand. Oh my goodness. All right, of course, it's famous. Almost everyone here has a smartphone. I know one person here actually doesn't have a phone, but I won't mention that name. As many of you already know, over half the U.S. population are now smart users, and it's projected to increase to over 70% in the next several years. That's over 200 million people. That's crazy. What's even crazier is how we're associating with our smartphones. We now spend more time with our smartphones than any significant other in our lives combined. Though this comes at no surprise, with this little black box that I call a smartphone, I have more power than the computers used in the Apollo mission, and at the simple click of a button, I can connect almost anyone in the world instantaneously. What a phenomenal accomplishment. However, there are unforeseen consequences, specifically in the area of psychology. Studies show that smartphone users are developing addictions identical to gambling addictions. Smartphones have the potential to bring the most widespread addiction to U.S. history. My name is Jeff Butler. I'm a serial entrepreneur, and I'm absolutely fascinated on how technology influences the human mind. In this talk, you'll hear about my own personal experience with smartphone addiction, but also from experts in the field who've been studying this for much longer than myself, such as Leslie Perlow and Nicholas Carr. The point of the speech is to articulate the unintended consequences that recent innovation has had on your mind. And more importantly, to give you some things after this Sunday evening, or Sunday morning actually, to go out and be able to be more productive and have a better relationship with technology. More specifically, the first part of the talk will go into how does an average smartphone user like you and me get pulled into becoming a chronic user? Two, what are some of the psychological effects that happen with your brain when you're using this technology chronically? And three, five tips that you can use today to start getting more time out of your smartphone technology. To begin, I'd like to start with the story of how I began studying smartphone addiction. It began 8 months ago, and I was sitting across from my manager at the time, and I was sweating. I was nervous. It's been 3 months I've been preparing for this meeting. I was shaking a little bit. I had my notes like this, right next to me, and I looked at him in the eye and I said, Mike, I'm going to be leaving this workplace. I'm going to go out as an entrepreneur and pursue my dreams. And he looked over at me afterwards and he said, okay. So I put in my 2 week notice and I went out on my journey. I had books, I had mentors, I had money all set and ready to go. 1 month into the journey, I had a wall, an insurmountable wall. I had chronic insomnia and I had no ability to focus whatsoever. As many of you can tell, I'm not very old. I don't have a huge nest egg built up to fall back on, but at the time I was losing thousands of dollars per month. Fortunately, since I studied psychology for almost a decade, I went out and I decided to figure out what is going on with my brain? What is happening? And I arrived at a question that I hope no one in this room ever was asked or had to ask someone else. And that question was, am I an addict? Am I addicted? Am I so pulled into technology that I cannot operate on a day-to-day basis? That was the question. My dreams, aspiration, money was all on the line. Well, in order to figure out if this really was the case, I decided to figure out how does an average smartphone user like you and me get pulled in to becoming a chronic smartphone user. And I found out there are three large areas how this happens. The first one is the neurological cycle that we get caught in. It begins with a four-letter word called a ping. And for those of you who don't know what a ping is, that's a notification, newsletter, or some app on your phone telling you that there's a 1 degree change in the weather. Any of the above, you receive this ping and you feel better. Why? New information, someone says, hey, I was thinking about you. Great, I feel awesome. But what happens underneath that is the brain then associates, it puts dopamine out, right? And once that takes place, the brain says, okay, neuroassociation, dopamine with the notification. The bond is formed. Now, you look for more dopamine or stimulation. What do you look for? Look for the pain. And the cycle continues over and over and over again until something else happens. Your brain adapts. It becomes desensitized. Now you need more stimulation to get to that same level of high. Those 5, 10, 15, 20 notifications now become 50, 100, 200 just to maintain that same level. Simply because you're trying to maintain that dopamine high. That's the first way to get pulled in. Now the second way is talked about in Leslie Pearl's book, Sleeping with Your Smartphone, where she's doing a study on a Boston consulting group trying to figure out a predictable time off really helps productivity. And during her case study, she found out that we are in a 24/7 responsive culture. What does that mean? How many of you got upset when someone didn't respond to a text message fast enough or a call? Just raise your hand. You know, I'm sure every single person's gotten mad a little bit. I got mad actually last night at someone for doing that. They didn't get back to me until 12 o'clock at midnight when I was asleep. But when that happens, you have this obligation that they put forth on someone else. And that other person, the recipient, maybe that's yourself, you have about 3 hours of the day where you're available to be contacted, right? Someone makes an extra obligation saying, hey, I want you to be more available right now. Extend that for an hour just for me. And of course, your good friend, family member, what have you, you extend. And slowly but surely, you start extending further and further and further because of other people's obligations. Reaching a point where you're literally sleeping next to your phone because you're trying to be a good friend, co-worker, or family member to be available for more people more often. Simply because the convenience of technology is now backfired, making it easier for people to contact you. That's the second way to get pulled in. Now the third way, how many of you are familiar with BART? Everyone familiar with BART here? Yeah, BART member? Okay, good. I take BART a lot. I love it. I'm just go to the city all the time with that. And about 18 months ago, I was sitting next to a two-year-old on BART. And this led to the third way I found out people got pulled in. And I was blown away. And it wasn't because the two-year-old had an iPad in their hand and the parent wasn't around. But it was because the two-year-old could work that iPad better than I could. And I'm a science major from Berkeley. And I'm like, how does this two-year-old do this? It's doing all these crazy gesticulations. I had no idea. But why is that? Why does a two-year-old able to work with that technology so well when their parent wasn't teaching them? They learned it all on their own, right? It's because we've made such great strides in the area of user interfaces to the point where almost any demographic can now pick up a device and use it like that. Phenomenal. But then as a consequence, what that means then is that whenever you pick up a device, you can get pulled into that much easier. Imagine if it was hard. I wouldn't be up here right now talking about this, but since it's so easy, you can just get pulled in that much easier. So that's the third way, is the user interfaces and how much they progress over the decades. Now, I'm sure many of you experienced one of those symptoms at some point. You're probably wondering, okay, what happens to my brain, Jeff? What goes on when I'm using this chronically? Because obviously smartphones aren't the best thing, but they're really awesome. What actually happens? Well, there's a lot of different symptoms, but I'll go into just three. And the first one is insomnia. Now, anyone who's a psychology fanatic in here realizes, hey, insomnia is caused if anything's wrong with the person, which is true. But smartphones have been shown to cause insomnia in two different ways. First way, this little blue light on my phone, if any of you can see it. Okay, when that blue light's going on, it tells your brain to turn on. So when you have it on before you go to bed, it's going to be a lot harder to fall asleep. Very simple. Brain's up here, you want to transition down. Very simple process right there. Okay, fine. Second area is a little bit more interesting. Smartphones have only been around for 22 years. What does that mean? That your brain has not been able to adapt to the rapid pace that it brings you. Have your smartphone on a lot? What that happens then is that you're now able to, or not able to, keep up. Your brain is literally sprinting to keep up with this technology, leading to a point where your brain's on top speed and you're going to sleep. Look, you're not going to be able to fall asleep. Going up one level, with the neurological inclination that you have from the last part I talked about, I don't know if you ever had this happen, but did you ever wake up in the middle of the night and just want to check your email? Or check your text message from a friend? Some of you might have done that. But it actually, you're getting so adapted to that hit that you'll wake up in the middle of the night and say, oh, I gotta use the bathroom, let me just check my phone while I'm at it. Happens, but it leads to some cases of insomnia. That's the first way, or neurological effect that people experience. Second, neurological effect. As I mentioned previously, but it was really emphasized when I was actually working on my speech one time. I was in San Francisco in a public speaking boot camp. And I had this excellent trainer saying, Jeff, do this, Jeff, do that, you missed that point. And I was working on my psychology effect speech a lot. And one of the people afterwards comes up to me and says, Jeff, I love your speech, I got a problem. And if you hear the sentence, someone says the sentence, or you say the sentence, chances are, there's an issue. But she went to me and said, Jeff, my phone runs my life. That simple sentence. Now, why is that the case? That sounds so funny. My phone runs my life. Really? But the phone works as a bridge of the outside world. Obligations are now pressed on you to be more available more often, right? Your spouse may want you to be available to take a call in the middle of the night for her. Maybe she's going to the airport, right? I don't know. But because of those obligations, the phone really works as a bridge for the outside world to put further obligations on. Very simple, fine, but you just need to be aware, hey, that's going to happen to the point where you might be on your phone all the time simply because you're trying to keep up with external obligations. Okay. Now those are two effects. Not so bad. Time, a little insomnia, who sleeps well anyway. The third one is why I even started a company that helps people overcome technology addictions and distractions. And it's because research shows that through prolonged use of smartphone technology, users lose their ability to focus on long, sustained tasks. Reading, writing, or having an in-depth conversation with a friend. Here's kind of a wild thing I'm going to throw out here. How many of you at one point actually kind of tuned me out and just started focusing on something else a little bit? Right? You're just like, oh, I have some groceries to do after this or something. You know, you just go off on tangent. But it's that focus what you lose. Because your brain becomes so conditioned to the rapid pace and frequency of dopamine that's over and over and over. Not a bad thing. Convenience factor, in a way, it's backfiring. Okay? So losing that ability to focus on long-sustained tasks is what I experienced when I was trying to work on my company. I had all the work in front of me, and I wasn't able to do it. I was like, are you kidding me? My brain is not working. I'm not nervous. I need to get this done. There's money on the line. I can do it. So those are three psychological effects: insomnia, having been on all the time, and losing your attention on long sustained tasks. Now, I'm sure many of you are like, great, that's Jeff, you really exploited the problem. Now what do I do? And I wrote down five things that you can do today to have basically a healthier, more cohesive relationship with technology. Because honestly, it's not going away, right? I personally, most of my business runs online. I need to learn how to have a more cohesive relationship with technology. But there's something that I want each and every one of you to understand. Is that throughout history, there's always a brilliant innovation and an underlying unintended consequence. Paper mail. Paper mail came out, hey, you can send a love letter across the United States in a couple days, hear back within a week. Phenomenal. That led to junk mail and advertising. You know what's funny? I was actually doing a speech at a company on technology distraction. People had their phones on, like, okay. Just take a minute, make sure everyone's phone is silent. I know I have to turn your phone on silent, so if you haven't already, please turn your phone on silent. It's really ironic during a technology distraction speech and someone's phone goes off. Really? Come on. So where was that right now? Tangent. So another example, take cars, right? Excellent, you can go state to state today. But now we have a pollution problem that we're still wrestling with. That's putting our planet in jeopardy, right? The same thing happens with this technology. Brilliant innovation. You can do so many things with your smartphone, but underlying psychological effects, unintended. No one can really foresee it, but hey, now we need to know how to deal with it to move forward with this technology. So, five tips that you can start using today to be more productive with technology. First one. Pomodoro technique. I don't know if anyone here has heard of it, but essentially having 30-minute blocks, 25 minutes undistracted, focused productivity time, 5 minutes of go crazy, social media, contact all your friends, go wild, right? But you alternate, go back and forth, why? Why is that old ancient technique so effective? It's because you're really training your brain to have focus time and have social media binge time. Right, going back and forth. That's the first technique. Second one, is implementing no technology zones in your life. For instance, first thing in the morning, an hour, keep that phone off. An hour before you go to bed, turn your phone off. Why? That helps the sleep cycle. But what about those points, speaking of presence, right? What about those points where you really want to be emotionally, physically, intellectually present in a conversation? Dinner table with your family. Maybe put a mandatory rule that, hey, smartphones go in the other room, right? So everyone can be there. That's why you have a family, right? To have those emotionally deaf moments. So it's a really good way of installing those no technology zones in your life. Third thing, this could really help when you're doing internet surfing, you don't end up at the bottom of YouTube somewhere. Okay, putting ad blockers on your browser. Advertisements are made to distract you. Okay? Because of this, your brain actually picks up on it. You'd be looking straight ahead, but the advertisement over here, your reticular activating system, subconscious mind, picks up on it. And you actually take some willpower to stay focused on what you're trying to read. Over a period of time, you start looking at the advertisements. And slowly but surely, you'll click on one. And there you're lost. You're gone. No hope for you. But the point is to add that ad blocker so you're not removing advertisements, because I literally spent a long time trying to figure out what's going to be pull someone in to distract them from what they're trying to do. And imagine all the other marketers out there are trying to do the exact same thing. And your job is to overcome those obstacles and stay focused, but you have a finite amount of willpower that you're struggling with here. So make sure that you put a little ad blocker for free. I don't endorse any of them, I'm just saying, add them. Next, this would also help internet browsing. It's called conscious surfing. Okay? Now, how does this work? Simple. When you're going online and you have an objective, write it down. Hey, I want to find an article to support my psychology effects presentation. Write it down. But you have a notepad on the computer. Go find article. Go online, try and find it. If the website doesn't have it, write down, hey, the website didn't have it. Go to another website. Check it. Website didn't have it either. And you go this back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. Why? That takes a long time, I know, but why would you do that? It's because you're in a reactive state online and a proactive state on the text sheet. And what happens is that you're able to maintain state in your mind very efficiently and stay on task on what you're trying to accomplish. And that will save a lot of time. And lastly, fifth technique or tip. Is where the psychology of this begins. And that is, if you hear that pull, you know what I'm talking about? That pull you have to check your phone, a text message or an email, and sign that weird England feeling? Okay, write down why that is. Just write down, I feel that I want to check my email right now. But why? Maybe you have a boss that's just totally overbearing, or maybe you're worried that I'm not going to respond fast enough to a friend who's overseas, but you write that down, you start really getting down to the fundamentals of why your brain's working the way it does. And then from there, you take the proactive approach in reality to be, take care of that source, okay? Writing down why. So there are five tips. Pomodoro technique, no technology zones, ad blockers, conscious surfing, and fifth is writing down why. To reiterate over this speech, what I went over is, has an average smartphone user, like you and me, get pulled into becoming a proactive smartphone user? Two, some of the psychological effects that take place in your brain. And third, five techniques that you can use today to be more productive with technology. In conclusion, as many of you noticed, technology is becoming more of a part of our lives every single day. A recent study came out that says the average smartphone user spends staring, not caring, but staring at their phone almost 35 hours per week. Now, is this an astronomical number? An indication that there's a widespread addiction taking place, or a tool that we have is becoming more effective for more parts of our lives? To be frank, it's very difficult to diagnose a widespread addiction. But what we do know is that research shows that smartphone users, through chronic and perpetual use, lose their ability to focus on long-sustained tasks, reading, writing, or having a present, in-depth conversation with a family member or friend. The ability to focus is one of the greatest attributes you've ever been given. A goal or dream that you set out for yourself, your ability to focus is one of the main determinants of whether or not you will reach that goal. People who cannot focus will feel their dreams, aspirations, and vocations slip away through the fingers. And what that means is that there's a call to action. To realize that smartphones have a brilliant innovation, but an unintended consequence underneath. And it's, you need to take more, or rather different approaches, methodologies, to work with this technology in order to mitigate the negative psychological effects. And once you do, there will be a paradigm shift within you. And instead of technology being distracting, addictive, or a hindrance to your goals, it will become a source of empowerment and control. I'd like to leave you with a quote. I actually did a speech at Google last week, and I left this quote for them, but I think it's very relevant for any car, actually. And this is what a past CEO of Google, named Google, Eric Schmidt, said. Okay? He was doing a keynote to the University of California, Berkeley, the graduating class. And he said, "Now don't get me wrong, I believe fully in the power of technology to change the world for the better. And I believe even more fully in the ability of your generation to use that power to great effect, to real technology. But you can't let technology rule you." Thank you.
All right, on that note, let's sing another song. Which I'm gonna look up the lyrics. I didn't want to look up the lyrics while you were talking, Jeff. You did good. Awesome. So our next segment is when a member of our community takes the mic to tell us about a moment when they've tried to live better, help often, and wonder more. Today's Doing Our Best segment will be given by Dan, who's going to talk about forming community in the wake of tragedy.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning. Good
morning. It is really just energizing to be in the space and to see so many smiles and faces and people. And it's been like a pretty terrible and good week at the same time. And last Sunday, sort of through social media, I heard about a terrible event that I know you all heard about in Orlando. And last June, at this time, we heard about a terrible event through social media in South Carolina at a church where 9 people were killed, and then this past Sunday, 49 people were murdered, and 53 people went to the hospital. And I didn't know what to do, because I'm in California, and like, what did I have friends who are in Orlando, I have cousins in Kissimmee County, and these things, and just this sort of helplessness came upon me, and I didn't really know what to do, and I was like, what am I supposed to do? I'm trying to be present. We're in our community. This past week, a little girl in Oakland was shot dead after she left a funeral, and it's like, this is what's happening. And what I love about Sunday Assembly is we gather, and we hope, and we help, and we try to hold up this positive love in a world that's full of a lot of pain. And for me, a lot of this week has been trying to figure out what is a response that I can do as a member in community. And last week I was confused and didn't really know what to do, and then I heard there was going to be a vigil in the Castro. And maybe like naively I was like, maybe there'll be like a few hundred people. Like maybe no one, who cares? And then I went and there were like 5,000 people up and down the street. I was like, holy smokes. Like this is... And my sister, who now lives in Rhode Island, told me that like 1,000 people in Providence, Rhode Island, gathered around the State House to hold a vigil, to hold up life. And I was like, what the heck? So even in this time of pain, people find ways to be present. And when I was in the Castro neighborhood, it was just this overwhelming sense of people who were Black, Brown, Latino, Asian, young, old, gay, straight, Black, white, atheist, believers, like everything. I knew like one or two people who were there, but somehow, even though we were all different, we came to this space to bear witness to a particular type of idea of how people should relate to each other. And it didn't really matter that we thought we were good with God or good without God, we cared about good. We cared about how we find a way to hold up something better. And it was really striking at one point, one of the speakers was a woman whose sister had been killed in North Carolina. She was related to the Muslim family that had been killed. She's a doctor and SF general, and she spoke about the common pain and the common opportunity to build something better, even amongst our differences. And then there was singing, and there was some Unitarian song that I come from a Unitarian tradition called We Are a Gentle Angry People, when I was at my Unitarian church in Rhode Island, I was like, this is a ridiculous song. Like, it's like a well-meaning, but like, we are a gentle, angry people. What is this? Then, feeling like a jerk. In the Castro, I find out that comes from when Harvey Milk was assassinated, and a group of people created that song in response to that. So it's not just like a hippy-dippy whatever, like it comes from real pain and real people and real experiences. And then the San Francisco Gay Men's Chorus like led 5,000 people marching from Castro to San Francisco City Hall singing that song. And I was overwhelmed and excited and sad that this is what brought us together, but we were together. And then over the course of the week, as bored at Sunday, so we're like, what do we do? We're trying to figure something out. Maybe we do a blood drive. Contacted some of the other assemblies. What are you doing? I don't really know. Maybe we do a blood drive. And then in the course of the week, I received an email from someone on our listserv who was like, it's really great that we mentioned these opportunities to contribute to the fund in Orlando and other things, but it shouldn't take massive, it shouldn't take massive visible death for us to think about a different way to help often. And I've been thinking about that a lot in the last couple days since I received that email. And I don't know what the answer is, but I know in community, really creative things come about and grow. And for me, one thing that I, if you asked me a year ago what my favorite thing about Sunday Assembly would be, I would be like, oh, like the community and the friends, which is still true. But my second favorite thing is singing once a month to elderly people here in Berkeley. And that's what we do as a service project. We go to a nursing home and sing songs like Time After Time with seniors at an elderly facility here in Berkeley. And that's really one of the favorite things I do each month. And that never would have happened without a community like this and random creative ideas that just people in goodwill create. And I don't know what we can do in response to these terrible things that happen here a few blocks away in Oakland, in Orlando, but I know that in this room, there are really caring, conscious, well-meaning people, and through some creative solutions, we will create more good. And that's what I'm trying to do my best at, is to work, you figure out what we can do, I don't know, but I'm really happy to be here, and thank you.
So we've had a lot of wonderful and thought-provoking things come up, so we're gonna take 2 minutes to just sit quietly and think about that, whatever you need to do, close your eyes and I'll let you know. And welcome. So for our next portion, we're going to do the collection. Sunday Assembly is free to attend, but it is not free to put on. You have to pay rent, buy supplies, post on Meetup, etc., etc. So if you are able and feel moved, please help share our expenses. We also have PayPal on our website. And as the collection goes around, I have another fun activity to share with your neighbor. The story of your first cell phone, when you got it, what kind it was, how big it was, whether it had a cord, etc. So as we pass around the collection, we can talk about the very first mobile or cell phone.
Thank you.
fun things with each other. This is the most exciting part of assembly. We're going to talk about announcements, I think, right?
Yes.
About things, and I need a flyer to do that way, because the slides are not right. So in the interim, so we meet here once a month on the third Sunday, but in between, for those of you who are new, we have small group meetings that we call SMOOPs, and that's an opportunity to continue the community that we build on Sundays and on other days, and to do fun things that people like to do. So we have, just to go, is it cool if I just go through these quickly, or do you want to come up?
They're corrections.
Things are not right. And then okay. The slides are not.
Get rid of the dates, and you could put just the title.
Sure. if information isn't correct today, you may find out more on Facebook and Meetup. There is a leadership potluck, is that correct? Sunday, July 3rd at 11 a.m. There is an acoustic smoop, Sunday, July 10th.
That's where you play music, bring your instruments. We had a euphonium there.
Wow.
Anyone who wants to watch the video of us playing, you guys can come see me at potluck.
And you don't have to be an amazing musician to go. You can just come and learn chords and strum along and play ukulele. There's a philosophy soup. Do you want to talk about that?
It's Monday the 27th at my place in the Diamond District of Oakland. And the discussion topic is animal rights specifically, and in general, what is the basis of rights?
Awesome. You're just jumping around with me. There's the singing that Dan was talking about, but I keep trying to go into the next one.
Next Sunday,
the 26th. So you get to go and sing songs to seniors and help bring joy to their day. There's a hiking swoop. Next one, Saturday, July 2nd. Anyone?
Yeah, that's me. So Saturday, July 2nd, Redwood Regional Park, Canyon Meadows Staging Area, 10 a.m. So I'll be there. Now, I'm also an event organizer for East Bay Hikers, so I'll have a sign that says East Bay Hikers here. But yes.
The question, is it dog friendly?
Yes. Dogs must, up to a certain point, be on a leash, but dogs are welcome, so. Yes. There's going to be 200 feet worth of elevation gain loss. We're starting out at Canyon Meadows Staging Area, 2.5 miles away to Skylight Staging Area. We're gaining a couple hundred feet there. And then, depending upon what the group wants to do, we'll either turn around and come back, or take the East Ridge Trail back, or take the West Ridge Trail back.
And are there any more smoops that need
yes,
to
be Yes, there's Read Out Loud smoop. Don't look at the program, because that was when we were meeting on the fourth Sunday, so it made sense to have it on the third Friday. But we're going to change that, but we haven't changed it yet. So just watch Meetup, watch Facebook,
and it'll read aloud.
Yeah, Read Out Loud smoop. So we come and bring random readings, and it's always very interesting because we kind of talk a little bit and read a little bit.
Where on Facebook can one find this?
There is a Sunday Assembly East Bay group.
Check the Meetup. Meetup is the one
yeah,
that
Meetup. Meetups? Meetup.
Yeah, yeah. Meetup. And you can check Meetup even if you're not a member.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or come talk to me.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. Right.
I won't respond immediately.
For all of these smoops, if you sign up in the sign up sheet, whether or not the information is right there, you will receive an email with a link to where you would go for the most updated information. Also, there's a service project on here, which is helping out at Little Farm. We did this last year with Berkeley Kiwanis, which I'm a part of. And we go up, and Little Farm is this amazing education center that has live animals, so if you want some pig, you got some bunnies and things like that, and do some service. We usually do some weeding and fence fixing and things like that. So if you want to come, please join.
So, and yes, so for any more information about that, you can talk to any of the people that stood up or go back to that table during the potluck and chat and find out more.
I just want to put in a quick word for it, may I ask, if you are interested in helping us make music or make music better, please join us for the next singing planning meeting or singing rehearsal. They are going to be posted on Meetup. Originally, the date for the next meeting was supposed to be July 3rd, but being that that's a holiday meeting, we'll probably be there next time.
Awesome. And so the other thing is, when you guys come in, if you can, we're trying to like track a little bit better, like who's coming and who's here and stuff. So if you didn't get a chance to sign in and grab your button, et cetera, when you got here, you can go and sign in as a returning member, or sign in as a new member, so we can kind of see who's who and what's what and all that fun stuff. So any more announcements that need to be made? In closing, it's kind of, this is like a doing my best supplementary edition. Just kind of talking about being present, and I guess selfishly just something I've kind of been thinking about since last weekend. I'm from Orlando, Florida. Often people come up to me and they say, so what was it like growing up in Florida? And growing up in Florida was fabulous. I think it's probably very similar to people that have grown up in California. You have the beach, you have Disney, you have theme parks, you have lakes. I spent a lot of time outdoors. It was a great place to be a kid. I think Florida has a little bit of a tarnished reputation for a lot of people, you know, politically and whatnot. So people are like, oh, Florida. It was a great place to be a kid. And I left at 14. I went to boarding school. So, you know, I left before I had a chance to be an adult there. It just lives in my mind as this place where I was a kid. You know, but in the world of Facebook and social media, I have a lot of friends that are still there from my childhood. And so after last weekend, just seeing the, like, checking in safe and all of that, like, really was a powerful week for me. But it led me to think a little bit about my childhood, about my life. I consider myself a pretty radically inclusive person now, like someday something. I try to be. I, as a cisgender, white, straight female without identifying as having a disability, I try to be an ally to a lot of the groups that face oppression, discrimination, prejudice, and hate in the world where that should no longer exist. I do my best, is what I wrote. But I had to learn and grow through my own judgments and prejudices. When I was in sixth grade, I was walking to McDonald's with my friend Ryder. I lived like a mile away from my school, but my mom would never let me walk to school because she thought I was going to get hit by a car. But Orlando was like a really safe place back then. Like it didn't feel like a scary place to be in anyway. It was suburbia. But I wasn't allowed to walk to school, which was super annoying. But one day I got to walk to McDonald's with my friend Ryder. So I remember it because it was like a really special occasion that I got to leave school and walk somewhere. And we were talking about whatever, you know, 11-year-olds talk about. And somehow the question, or the topic of being gay came up. And I said, being gay is wrong. Because I had heard that somewhere. My friend Ryder looked at me very combatively in horror and was like, why would you say that? I didn't have a good reason why I said that. I had heard it somewhere. Someone in a position of authority at some point in my life, in my church, in my family, had told me that was the case, so that was the case, because I was 11. And he said to me, Hester, you know Melissa Etheridge is gay, right? And I said, what? But I like her music. And that was it. And I was done. That was it was very easy for me because I think deep down, like I've always been kind of, you know, a critical thinking person, and it just took that moment of going like, you're talking about a person, Hester, not a phrase that you heard at your church. And so, you know, obviously I had to like make a lot more of those steps to get to where I am, and I still do. Sorry. Oh, I took screenshots of my computer. The rest of this is on the next one. I grew from there. I still do. I said that. So I try to be an empathetic person. And so, yeah, I guess just the last thing, my thought was, as we all seek to understand and to process the events in Orlando, the labels that are being thrown around, the just generalizations that are being thrown around about everything that happens, what I feel like I can do is go out and seek to love and to understand and to be empathetic to everyone. And so I hope we can all do that. And also, because it's very important, we should all have some fun.
Yeah.
screen was.
Sari reminded me this morning that we are a group of people, not perfect people, and that we have lives and that things happen, and I think that that's a really important thing to remember. So as the imperfect, wonderfully amazing people that we are, let's go live better, help often, wonder more, and eat food.